Hello TaleForgers! In this video we'll expand the BlobAssets topic to include retrieving data from scriptable objects. We'll be able to collect object and show a message with points. So let's waste no time and get started. First of all, let's create a collectible type enum, which will come in handy when defining our data container, that is scriptable object. Let's add three values, none, gold coin and bronze coin. Next, let's move on to creating an SO. Let's create new directory data and inside it an empty class CollectibleSO inheriting from the scriptable object. If anyone doesn't know what scriptable object is, in a nutshell, it's a data container that we can modify from the editor. A great design tool that allows us to tweak parameters and requires no programming skills. Okay, adjust namespace to the TaleForge.ECS. So let's add create asset menu attribute with file name new collectible, menu name TaleForge/collectibles. We need two parameters, the collectible type created earlier, and the points, which in turn we used in the previous video. So let's go to the Unity and add a new directory called data. Here we can add two scriptable objects, one for bronze coin and one for gold coin. Of course, set the corresponding collectible types. For the gold coin, I set 5 points, and for the bronze coin, 1 point. Now it is time to go back to the code and add collectible type in the collectible container struct. Okay, so let's adjust the implementation of the classes CollectibleAffering and Baker. First of all, let's modify the float parameter to the CollectibleSO for both SerializeField and Getter. In the CreateCollectibleBlobAsset method, let's replace the float type with CollectibleSO. Then let's cache the collectible data index. We will need the data to retrieve two variables, type and points. And remember to pass the parameters to the array builder. It's time to handle collectible detection. So let's go to the player detection component data and create a new field. Public collision filter, collectible collision filter. Then, analogous to what we did in the previous videos, we add collectible belongs to and collectible collide with a getter of type collision filter. In bake method, let's pass collectible collision filter as a parameter. Next, go to the player detection aspect and add new getter. Public collision filter, collectible collision filter, player detection component data dot value RO dot collectible collision filter. It is time to extend the player detection system implementation. First, let's add the private collision filter, collectible collision filter field. Of course, we need to assign the variable in the onStartRunning method. We get the value from aspect. Next, let's pass the collectible collision filter to the player detection job, in which we need to define another variable. First, let's refactor the previous code, move the check to see if the player is grounded to the handle ground collision detection method. Next, let's wrap the code responsible for checking whether the player has reached the end flag in the handle end flag collision detection method. Now we can create a new method, handle collectible collision detection, and pass two parameters, local transform and box geometry. Let's add best compile attributes to each of the newly created methods. Now create a native list to store all the detected hits, of course with the allocator set to temp job. And let's do a check. Bool is collectible equal overlap box local transform, which let's refactor to player transform, then pass box geometry, ref hits, collectible collision filter. If a collectible hit is detected, let's go through the list of all the hits and add a component to the entity, collected collectible component data. Finally, let's remember to add dispose for the hits. We need to add flag, our marker, so let's create new iComponent data, collected collectible component data. We treat this as a flag only, without any fields. And we get rid of the error in the player detection system. We need to specify the type of objects we are placing in the scene, so that we can retrieve the necessary data at the time of the call. There are advantages and disadvantages to this approach. The advantage is that we only keep the type in memory, without all the necessary parameters. In our case, it's only one additional parameter, points. But in reality, there could be a lot of them. Then, each component data, and let's say there are 1000 of them, would occupy memory. On the other hand, the disadvantages are the increased complexity of the code and the need to search through the blob asset to find the type corresponding to the collectible. Okay, so let's add a public collectible type, type variable. Next, let's create a scene collectible offering class inheriting from mono behavior. By standard, we'll add a serialized field, collectible type, with a getter. In the baker, we need to get entity and add component. Scene collectible component data with parameter type. Thanks to this implementation, we'll be able to determine which collectible is detected. Okay, let's select the collectible system. First of all, let's change update in group to update after. I want to execute collectible system after player detection system. I can also remove iSystem start stop interface, I don't need it anymore. Copy and paste blob array related code to the onUpdate method and of course remove onStartRunning and onStopRunning methods. Let's create private entity query collected collectible entity query and write inside onCreate entity query equals systemapi.querybuilder.withAll collected collectible component data dot build. Don't forget to add state dot require for update collected collectible entity query. It's time to handle collectible logic. We'll need native array entity with temp allocator with all our collected collectibles. Then inside the for loop, we can iterate over each element and execute collectible logic. Pass parameters, ref state, collected collectibles, index, and ref collectible data. At the end of the method, dispose native array. So let's implement base compy private void execute collectible logic, ref system state state, native array entity collected collectibles, int index, ref blob array collectible container, collectible data. I want to show debug.log with points and destroy collected entity. So let's get components scene collectible component data, pass collected collectible at index as a parameter. Next, let's write for loop and cache collectible data in the collectible container variable. If collectible container.type equals sync collectible component data.type, we can execute debug.log logic, destroy entity collected collectible index, and break. Great. Okay, back to Unity, wait for the compilation process to finish, and let's create a new folder inside graphics, 3D. Then add the collectible models, for me it will be gold coin and bronze coin FBX. Let's go to the prefabs folder and add a subfolder, collectibles. We need to prepare abstract prefab and two variants prefabs for gold and bronze coin. So let's create an empty object on the scene. First of all, let's add two components, physics shape and physics body. Physics body will be static, so there is no a big problem. For physics shape, we need to configure the collision filter. First, let's add a new physics category name, collectible. Then we can set belongs to parameter to the newly created collectible and collides with setting to the player. This will allow us to detect collision with the object. Attach new component, sync collectible afferent and leave it as default. Important note, the only way children get automatically deleted when destroying the parent is if the parent has a linked entity group buffer on it. This is added by default to baked prefabs, but not game objects in a subscene. That's why we need to add linked entity group afferent component. Drag and drop collectible to folder and delete it from the scene. Now we can create two prefab variants, collectible gold coin and collectible bronze coin. Inside the first one, let's drag and drop gold coin, select gold coin type, adjust Z position, and fit enable render meshes. Inside the second one, drag and drop bronze coin, select bronze coin type, also adjust Z position, and fit enable render meshes. And that's it. Let's go to the ECS level 1 scene, select systems prefab, open it and select collectibles object, remove all elements from the list, then drag and drop our data, collectible gold coin and collectible bronze coin. Next, select player detection object and choose collectible belongs to as player and collectible collide with as collectible. Now it is time to add coins to the scene, so open the level 1 prefab and put two coins in it. It will do it fast forward. Okay, it's time to test everything. Go to the level scene, pick up collectible and we got an error. Let's check it out. As you can see from the error description, entity command buffer was recorded in the TaleForge ECS player detection system and played back in Unity entities and simulation command buffer system. The problem is inside the player detection system, which refers to an entity that doesn't exist. One of the solutions to this problem is to add the order last true parameter to the update in group attribute. Okay, let's see if everything is working properly in the Unity and play the game. Move to the collectibles and... yes, everything is working fine. Awesome. I would like to invite you to support us on the Patreon, where you can get the exclusive code, all models, materials or code used in this series, and access to early available content, link in the description. Thank you for your time, I'm glad you are with us and our community is growing. See you soon in the next video.